We're in Atlanta, and for those of you who are not from around here originally, you may go, where's Atlanta besides Georgia? It's the very northern tip of Hamilton County. As a matter of fact, we go about a block that direction, you're in Tipton County, so the very north part. We're at the Asher Walton House here in Atlanta, beautiful bed and breakfast. We're going to go in and see Larry and Lea Vaughn and get a little tour. Hang on. Great. Here is our lovely hostess, Lea Vaughn. How you doing?
Good. Nice to see you. Come right on in.
Is Larry here today?
He is.
Well, I'll tell you what, Lea, would you just give us a little tour through the place and tell us about what we have here?
Okay. Come on in. Roy, this is the drawing room of the Asher Walton House. My husband Larry and I live here, and when we have guests, we just share the whole house with our guests.
Oh, really? So it's not like they're separated from where you are?
No. No. What we do is we have the drawing room and the music room and also a parlor. And they're very welcome to come down and sit wherever they want or, you know, play chess or read a book or play games. We have games and things that they like. So,
do you have guests coming from all over the country, all over the state?
We actually have a lot of local guests, especially from Indianapolis, Fishers, Carmel, and most of those guests are for special events such as birthdays, anniversaries, yeah. That sort of thing. And sometimes they'll come for one night, but sometimes for two. And we have a special package if they want. We'll have fresh flower arrangement for them. If it's a special anniversary or something, we have a complimentary bottle of champagne.
You give them a real welcoming party.
Yes, we sure do. My husband and I have always just treated our guests as family. That's what we do.
Well, that's really a nice attitude to have about it. It's kind of like our house is your house. Come on in.
Right. One of the stories I like to tell is about when my husband and I decided to open a bed and breakfast. I told one of my friends at work that I was going to be doing this, and she said, "What's different?" Because we have always had a lot of family, a lot of friends that come and visit, and so it was really nothing different.
Yeah, yeah. Lea, tell us about the house. How old is it? Who built it, and so on? And let's go on. I want to walk through a little bit and see some of the things as we walk.
The house was actually built in 1868, or I should say they started construction in 1868, and it took 4 years to build. Asher G. Walton built the home for his new bride, and he was a very prominent businessman at the time here in the town of Atlanta, and he had a bank across the street, and then he also had a lumber yard, a flour mill, and we were been told by the county historian that a lot of the lumber used in this home was imported. So I would guess through his channels, through his lumber yard,
company, yeah.
He would have those access to those suppliers. And the woodworking in the drawing room is actually red oak and mahogany. And we've been told by the county historian that the woodworking in this room actually, at the time the home was built, the American builders didn't have the skills to do this.
Yeah, well, you look at this. There's some incredible detail here, and
yeah.
It's very massive.
6 layers thick, and, I just can't imagine the craftsmanship that it took to do this. You just don't see this in homes today, of course.
Or if you had to replace it today, yeah.
Oh,
that's,
my.
That's something else again. Wow.
Right. Now, the stained glass, my husband has done, Larry. Since we've moved in, and
now, has he made the stained glass?
He has.
Ooh.
He learned from a neighbor how to do it, and I help him design it and pick the colors, and then he does the work.
You guys are quite the couple here, I tell you. That's very impressive. As far as the condition of the house, you've had it for how long?
We've been here soon be 7 years.
Okay. When you bought it, what kind of shape was it in? Was it fairly run down? You had to do a lot of building up or restoring?
Actually, the restoration was about 80% done. There had been a couple that had lived here for about 9.5 years who had done the majority of the renovation. And her health was failing, and they had to move away.
Hmm.
So my husband actually was here visiting with a business associate across the street at our little Main Street cafe, and he just nonchalantly said, you know, that house across the street is for sale. And I said, oh, really? So he came over and just knocked on the door, and he took a tour. But when he came home to tell me that there was this house in Atlanta, Indiana, that I just had to see, I thought he was crazy, because we had already spent about 7.5 years renovating a home in Noblesville.
Oh, you lived in Noblesville then?
Right. And so I thought we'd probably be there the rest of our lives.
Yes. Yeah.
So it took him about 3 weeks to get me to up here to even
look
at the house. Yes.
Ooh, you were a tough one, weren't you?
I was. But I was very pleasantly surprised when I found that the home was close to being completed. And we had a lot of antiques at the time, and the lady that was moving sold us a number of things, one of them being this piano here.
Now that is really a piece over there.
It was built in 1873, and when we purchased the home, we purchased the piano along with it, it didn't work. She had had it for a number of years, but only used it as a decorator piece.
Yeah.
We found a lady in Indianapolis that completely restored it, and it does play. I don't play, but you're welcome
to,
man, if you can.
That's amazing. So, that is, I mean, how old?
1873.
Any knowledge of the history?
No.
The story behind
it? I'm sorry.
It?
Larry May. He's the historian.
Okay. We'll find out later on, hopefully,
okay.
If that was here when the original people got here. Did they bring it in from some exotic place,
right,
or whatever?
Right. Okay.
Well, I want to see a lot more of the place, so
okay,
we're going to take a little more of a journey.
All right. That'd be great.
Okay. Question, is this two parlors here? Was this a dining room?
This was actually always the music room.
Oh, the music room,
of
yes.
Of course.
See, I'm from a different world. You know,
you
didn't have the music room.
And you didn't
have the TV room, you
exactly
know. That would be that now.
And you didn't have a parlor either. You have a den.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Right.
Tell me a little bit about it. I've noticed the flooring in here, the beautiful flooring in there and everything. I see carpet here. It looks like they have evidently kept that away from carpet for quite some time. You told me a rather unique story about what you've been told about this floor that we're on right now.
The floor here in the parlor, we were told by Juliana Walton Payne, who's the granddaughter of Asher G. Walton. She came here for a visit a few years ago. She was 83 at the time and was going to her 60th class reunion at Indiana University and was visiting from Texas. She told us that originally this floor here in the parlor was a tri-color wood floor that was actually red oak, walnut, and mahogany, and it was a big starburst.
Oh, wow.
So we got all excited because it had old carpeting on it, so we, of course, wanting to replace the carpeting anyway, and we ripped it up, and the only thing under this room is subflooring. So sometime over the years, it's disappeared from the house.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, what a classic story, though. I mean, I'm sure she remembers from her childhood and stuff, that's something that's missing now that was here before. The fireplaces, old houses again, heat was different from what we have today. And so you see fireplaces throughout houses and stuff.
These fireplaces aren't real big. They were used mostly to burn coal.
Mm-hmm. Oh, coal?
Yes.
Aha.
Now, as far as the dark colors that you see in Victorian homes, chances are that's probably why, because they burned coal. Plus, they had the steam engines going by every day.
That's right, we are very close to the
right.
Railroad tracks here.
Actually, it goes by, like during the festival, if you remember our Atlanta New Earth Festival,
yeah,
the steam engine visited.
Yes, yeah, you see it there.
Right.
Lee, tell me about the picture.
Oh, I will. This pen and ink drawing is a copy of one that was in the 1860 Hamilton County history book, and it is of the Asher Walton House. And as you see, it didn't have the big wraparound porch.
Yeah.
And it also had a wrought iron fence, which I wish was still there,
it's
gone. But people have often asked us, why is our address 100 East Main? when actually the house faces Railroad Street. But as you can see from the pen and ink drawing, the actual main entrance was here on Main Street.
Sure.
It came around and then on up onto the small porch and into the front door here in the parlor, which was that door there. That glass in the front door was handmade in Italy, we were told by Juliana Walton.
So that's not one of them Larry did?
No, that's an original glass. That was the only one left. She said they had similar ones throughout the house, but of course they've disappeared too.
Yeah, yeah. This door, do you still use it as a main entrance or
no.
just keep it blocked off?
We don't use that door at all.
Okay.
No.
You come in on the railroad side, I noticed.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's go on in.
Okay.
Have you got Larry hidden somewhere?
I think he's probably in the kitchen. That's where he spends a lot of time.
Oh, wait a minute. If my wife hears this, that there's a man in the kitchen, I'm going to be in trouble.
It looks like he already has the table set. This is the breakfast room where our guests have breakfast. We oftentimes will light the fire for them. And Larry is our main cook. Now, if he's not here and I have to substitute, I do a fine job. But people that have had Larry's muffins, they oftentimes say, oh, where's Larry?
You know, I'm standing here and I'm getting a whiff of these muffins now. And I'm going, I'm in trouble. My wife is never going to let me forget this.
Well, that was one of the bargains when we decided that, yes, we would have a bed and breakfast. Since he works at home and I work outside the home, that he would be the ones that would, he would have to be the one that would do most of the cooking.
Well, now tell me about it. So this is not your career. It's,
no.
It's an avocation, I guess, almost rather
right.
than...
Right. I'm actually an officer at Irwin Mortgage Corporation in our operations center at Fishers, Indiana. And I've worked for the company almost 17 years, and I serve as the vice president in the loan administration area.
Ha. And Larry? Besides cooking great muffins and probably a lot of other things.
Larry actually works here in the house, and he has his office upstairs in one of the bedrooms, and he does webinars.
Webinars?
Yes.
What is a webinar?
He actually does seminars over the internet, and he does this...
Webcasting, then.
Webcasting, and he uses, everyone calls into a call center, and they can talk and go through the exercises over the internet.
You guys, I don't know what you do in your spare time, but...
We actually do a lot of laundry here.
I would imagine that,
That was originally the dining room. The breakfast room, the room that we use for the breakfast room today was originally the dining room. The floor in this room is actually red oak and walnut. And the doors in this room, there's one unfinished over here in the corner that shows you the color scheme of the red oak and the walnut.
Yeah. Well, when you see this and that door, you can understand the validity in that floor we had talked about earlier.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah. Now, the area where we're standing now is currently a bath and a laundry room.
Uh-huh.
This originally, though, was their breakfast room.
This was?
Yes. This area here was their breakfast room, right off from the kitchen.
Wait a minute. Did I hear an alarm going off, a timer?
Uh-oh. And here
he is.
Larry.
Welcome. You just in time for some muffins.
We could smell them
Look
all the way
this
through
guy.
The house.
Larry. Oh, my goodness gracious.
What kind did you make?
These are Missouri pralines.
Whoa.
I tell you.
He makes up his own recipes a lot of the time.
And after they cool, I'll put the topping on them.
You know, I make up my own recipes a lot of the time, too. Yes, it's whatever mistake I've made, and then that becomes the new recipe.
Yeah. That's what the chef usually has to eat, is the mistake.
Yeah. This, you've really done this nicely, too. Did you have to do much of this? Was it primarily done?
The ceiling was already done, and the cabinets were in.
Do you know if they were original at all?
No, but we've been told by Juliana, the granddaughter, that there were some cabinets here in the kitchen, and that they were very similar to these.
Oh.
Now, how the people knew that, I don't know. On that wall, originally, of course, there was this huge, big fireplace, and two ovens, And Juliana said that her grandmother baked homemade bread every day.
Oh, I would imagine there was no sink.
No sink.
Yeah.
She said they had a table with the pan.
Sure, and they would have to go outside and pump.
Right.
Pump water.
No, actually, the pump was
cistern.
Right here.
Oh,
yeah.
The cistern is right outside the wall.
They brought it in.
The pump was right here, so they could pump it here.
Well, see, that's what you get when you're mm-hmm. Asher Walton.
That's right. That's right.
Go ahead. We're going up the stairs.
Yes, we'll go up and see the bedrooms. Here again, you'll notice the red oak and
yeah.
the walnut. And the red oak
yeah,
here.
The door's original,
the door.
Right?
Yes, the door is original. Now, Larry did the glass.
Okay.
The railing here, we've been told by the county historian that it's pretty unique in that not only does it curve, but it twists with your hand as you go up.
See, yeah, so as you... It's just an automatic feel to it.
Yeah, and so I like to point that out so people will yeah. enjoy that as they go up the steps.
Now, you had commented that that technology or that type of innovation probably wasn't real common here in the United States.
No, they seem to think that probably it was European builders that did this.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so make sure you notice the railing here.
And listen for the squeak on the 17th stair. Huh?
I think I overpowered it or something. Here at the top of the stairs, we have a landing, and you know our guests just love this little area.
Beautiful sitting area here.
Larry has lots of books on the Civil War. He's kind of a Civil War buff, and I keep all my family albums out here. People like to look at family pictures. It's
yeah.
silly. But they love to sit out here, and it overlooks Main Street.
Yeah, that's really nice.
So when the Indiana Transportation Museum brings a train up, it parks right out front.
Well, yeah. I mean, when we get on the train down in Fishers, for example,
mm-hmm.
and come up here to go to one of the restaurants or something, we come right here,
right
don't
here.
We?
Right here. Right in front of the Walton House.
It's great.
This bedroom we've called the Tate Room.
Tate room, okay.
Yes, and you say, Tate, well, why is that?
Are these the Tates?
No, it actually is not. These are our guests. They're here from Wisconsin, actually. And they have been here, I think this is your fourth visit?
Third or fourth visit,
yeah.
Can't find your way back to Wisconsin from here, or what? Well, let's just turn around and go back.
We like it here.
We appreciate you letting us invade your privacy here. When Larry and I decided to open the bed and breakfast, we talked about, well, what do we name the rooms? You know,
yeah.
all the bed and breakfasts, they name their rooms like flowers, trees, presidents,
right.
you know, that sort of thing. And so Larry said, well, you know, I'd really like to name one of the rooms after the original family, the Walton family. And he says, why don't we name the other rooms after our families?
Oh, that's nice.
Right. So this is the Roy D. Tate Room, and this is named after my father.
Aha.
And it's pretty appropriate in that he worked his whole life on the CB&Q Railroad in Hannibal, Missouri.
And here you are.
On Railroad Street.
Overlooking the railroad.
That's right, in the train.
That's neat. That's
yeah.
really neat.
So he likes that, I'm sure.
You know, you look at this room, and you see the curved wall at corner and stuff.
That is...
Very unique.
One of the most unique features of the home, and it makes it a little difficult to place a piece of furniture, but it is very pretty. People comment on that a lot.
Yeah, very nice.
Now, one of the things that I've noticed, too, when you're putting wallpaper and border on a curved wall, it's very difficult.
Really? Puckers and stuff?
Well, you can't keep it straight. It wants to go downhill.
All right, well... That's what you have Larry around here for.
Right.
Let him take care of that. Well, let's get out of their
okay.
way here. And we'll
thank you.
Thanks for letting us come in here. We're going down this way.
Okay.
Oh, no, look, see. Here's the curved wall from in here.
Right. Now, that's the one that's in the
back. But look at this. It's like, wow. I mean, it's curved on both sides. This is really neat. I guess that means that we have another room over here with a curved wall, too.
This room actually is Larry's office.
Aha.
Now, we named this room the Vaughn Room, which eventually, if we do have another bedroom, we would name this after his family, his dad, the L. Eugene Vaughn room.
Uh-huh. So is his dad's name Larry also?
His name was Lawrence. Eugene.
Okay.
And Larry is actually Lawrence Eugene Vaughn Jr., our son, Lawrence Eugene Vaughn III, and he goes by Link.
Link.
That's another story.
Okay. All right.
But this is where Larry works every day. I'm really kind of jealous some days because he gets to stay home, and I have to drive in to work. But
you get it run down.
This is the Walton's bedroom.
This is really quite a room.
And Juliana said that her grandfather always had a desk here in this window, which really made sense because it overlooked Main Street.
Yeah.
And he had the bank across the street. He could look out that window. He had the mercantile business, which is the
right.
big tall building
there. Yeah, right
there.
Over there.
And then when he looked out the left, he could see the lumber mill and the flour mill. So he
surveying
could,
his entire empire
exactly.
right here.
Wouldn't
you just love for just a short period of time to be able to go back to that time?
Love it.
And just see what it was like. It would just be so fascinating.
Juliana, when she was a child, every window in the house had shutters like in here. And her duty or chore every day was to make sure that she opened and closed the shutters at the correct times.
Oh, is that right?
To keep the house either cool or warm.
Sure.
So she didn't like these shutters very much.
Now, when you guys, did you put these up before that or after that?
No, these are the original shutters.
Oh, these are the original ones?
Not all. We don't
I thought
have
these
all.
Probably had been recent.
No, these are original. We don't have all of them throughout the house, but we have a number of them.
Well, I'm impressed to see that. I mean, look at the shape they're in. It's incredible.
This bedroom outfit my husband and I acquired when we were first married, and it's cherry wood, and it was handmade in England in the early 1800s.
This is a beautiful room. Oh, I'm in trouble with my wife, I know that.
All right, we'll go down and see the white room. Now, this is the room that Larry was telling you about that was originally Juliana's bedroom when she was a small child. And it overlooks the south lawn. Her grandmother always had a beautiful garden down there. I do a lot of gardening, but not probably like what she did. Our granddaughters, Megan and Lindy, love this room, of course. And if we have a male guest in here, I do gather up some of the little dolls and things. But Juliana loved this room because she said she could watch out in the yard and in the garden and know when her grandmother was out there, so she could go out and sit in the gazebo with her. So this is one of the smaller bedrooms, but you know, there's really something else unique about the house in that every bedroom had a closet. There's a coat closet in the hallway, and there's also a butler's pantry in the dining room, which now is the breakfast room. And that's unusual because in the Victorian era, they would tax for closets because they thought they were a luxury, of course.
Well, yeah, and didn't people have like armoires and stuff like that?
And that's why you don't see very many houses built in this era that have closets. They did. They had to have furniture.
They got taxed. That's interesting.
Yeah,
I interesting. Didn't know that one. Yeah. That's a new one on me.
A new thing that I learned since we moved here.
Yeah. Now, where are we going here?
Well, this is the hallway that leads to the staircase that goes back down to the breakfast or to the kitchen.
The kitchen area.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And as Larry was telling you earlier, this room, which is over the kitchen, was probably originally the servants' quarters.
All right.
And she could come up the back steps.
Because it is separated from the rest of the
right,
house.
Right, and that door would be closed, so she wouldn't even interrupt the rest of the family.
Yeah.
And yet
it would make sense, yeah.
She'd get up earlier probably and go down and start the meals, and then when they got up, they could eat.
Yeah. Well, you've really done a nice job with this room.
Oh, thank you.
Wow.
This, I think the bathroom, Juliana said, was moved into the house in the early 20s. Before that, of course, they had the outside toilet.
Sure.
But they didn't have to go outside to go to the toilet. They had their outside, outhouse?
The outhouses.
Was on the back of the stable. So they could walk out the back door through the breezeway to the stable, down the path on the side of the stable to the outhouse. And she said it had a skylight.
Oh, wow. Yeah. These people really did have
That's
it
right.
good. Yeah, this was really pretty fancy at that time then.
Now, I think this was the original tub, clawfoot tub, that was moved in or brought in when they did bring the plumbing indoors in the early 20s.
Very nice.
Our guests really like this room because it's a little unique. It's bigger than most baths, and we always, of course, have out a lot of bubble baths and candles and that sort of thing so they can enjoy their baths.
Yeah. How many rooms do you have available for guests?
We actually rent all three bedrooms that we have ready. They're, the fourth bedroom, of course, is Larry's office, and then we have a fifth bedroom that I didn't show you because that's where we keep a lot of our linens and our in storage of things. But we rent all three bedrooms. My husband and I will sleep in whichever bedroom isn't rented.
But well, you're flexible. That's
right.
Very nice.
But generally, we limit the number of guests that we have to either one or two couples. And the reason we do that is because they do share the Victorian bath here at the end of the hall. We don't have baths in the bedrooms. We don't have TV or telephone in the bedrooms. Mm-hmm. So when they come here, it really is getting away.
It's When you rent the rooms and stuff, is it just on weekends? Is it any time somebody needs a room?
We have a lot of guests that come during the week. They'll come to visit family, or they'll come, say, for a local wedding, and they'll stay 3 or 4 days. And we also have businesses like in Elwood or Tipton, Carmel, and Fishers that will tell their people about the bed and breakfast. And if they have, you know, businessmen or women that come into town that want to stay at a bed and breakfast, they'll
oh, that would be a real treat.
Yeah. Yeah,
very nice.
But we've had guests from all over the world.
I bet your register downstairs is interesting in itself just to read, huh? Your guest register.
Oh, yes. That and also our guest comments.
Oh, yeah.
We have a book out in each of the rooms, and most of our guests actually choose the Tate room in the front because they like overlooking Main Street and having the loft right there where they can read and enjoy just relaxing.
Well, let's move on to the next place.
All right. Uh-oh, we didn't warn you.
Larry is the microwave original. Look at this. Oh, my goodness.
This is a Mexican vanilla cappuccino topping.
Larry, you realize you've ruined life now for all males in Hamilton County that are going to watch. And if their wives watch this, we're all... We're dead meat.
I've heard in the past that I've raised the bar somewhat.
Yeah.
I'm a little apprehensive about it.
Well, and for some of us, raising it doesn't take it to too much of a level. You don't have to go too far to get it raised very far at all.
You know, one of my favorite things is to get to sleep in on the mornings that we have guests, since I have to get up so early every weekday. And Larry oftentimes will bring me breakfast in bed.
Oh, you're not supposed to tell things.
We better shut these microphones off real quick. Real quick. Oh, I just need to keep her busy so she doesn't see this show.
Oh, okay.
That's all.
You're going to get me into real trouble here.
Well, actually, Larry, you're going to be over at my house fairly soon.
They wanted to know a little bit about the early years here in Atlanta in the early 1900s when there were the natural gas was so plentiful and the town was booming.
Yeah, why was Atlanta such a bustling community?
Well, natural gas was discovered in Hamilton County, and I believe it was somewhere between Noblesville and Cicero in the 1880s. And it was a huge deposit of natural gas, which meant a free fuel source for factories. So the manufacturers wanted to come in here where they could get free fuel, and there was plentiful workforce available. And the deposits ran all the way from the north end, here where Atlanta is located, down to south of Noblesville. And it lasted, I'm told, until around the late 1920s, at which time it started running out and companies started looking for other locations. And that's when the population in the north end of Hamilton County started to decline.
What kind of factories? You said there was a glass factory and...
A glass factory, a large tin mill located here, and there were a couple of other metal manufacturing facilities located here. And the natural gas is what made it so attractive to them, because it made their cost of producing their products so low. And of course the railroad was very active through this area back then.
Now, is that what would have made Ashton Walton come here? I mean, why would he decide to be here and have the mercantile and the lumber yard and all the things that went on here? Any idea what brought him to those kinds of...
I haven't been able to make that particular connection. I know that he lived in Tipton with his uncle, Asher Goodrich, who had a mercantile and also had a wool producing facility of some sort. And Asher worked there. And when he reached his majority, according to the newspaper accounts I found, which was 18, he came here to Atlanta, which back then was named Buena Vista.
Oh, I didn't know that.
The original name was Buena Vista, all one word. It wasn't separated.
I had not heard that one before.
And there was a man who lived here who lived right across the street from the house here on the corner where the town hall is now, who had a mercantile store. And Asher went to work for him. His name was John Wolfe. In succeeding years, he married Mr. Wolfe's daughter and bought his business.
Okay.
And he was such a good business person, he was able to build his riches. He helped put a sawmiller into business. He put a flour miller into business. And they manufactured flour with a 3-stone mill for several years, and then had the first 5-stone grinding mill in this area. And they produced Kitchen Queen flour, which was sold all over the country.
We actually have a picture of one of the original flour sacks, and the only thing that we actually have that belonged to Asher G. Walton himself is a big leather bucket that Juliana brought us that he used to measure the grain with in the flour.
That's quite a find. That was very nice of her.
Very nice.
Quite a find. Yeah, it's amazing to me in Hamilton County when I find these things out, the incredible amount of economy that was going on here and was such a base part of this entire county, from Noblesville to Mud Sock to up here in Buena Vista.
Right.
You know, it's just amazing to me the amount of economy
Mr.
that
Walton
happened.
Mr. Walton was very much involved in a lot of efforts. He was a stockholder, I'm not certain how involved he was, in the First National Bank of Noblesville. He was involved in businesses in Tipton. He was one of the incorporators of the County Line Road that actually carved out and paved the first road that went between the Tipton and Hamilton counties, running east and west here.
Yeah. Again, just incredible bits of history. And more information about Hamilton County that I'm sure very few people that are going to be watching this are aware of. And thanks very much to you guys,
Thank you.
Larry and Lea Vaughn, for sharing all this with us. And Larry, I'm assuming you're planning on sharing those with us. I know Rick insists that you share those with us.
So. You have to try one before you leave.
Very soon, Rick will be shutting off the camera and dashing toward the muffins here. But thanks very much.
Thank you.
Larry, this is outstanding. Will you marry me? Oh, Larry, my man!